Welcome to this session of our course on basic electronics. Today's topic is operational amplifiers. I would like to just take up a few topics. First of all, thanks for all the questions that you have been sending to me. I have responded to a few on the Moodle site, so you will find those answers there. However, some questions have been sent to me by email, which I don't find on the Moodle. I don't know how these were sent. And when I try to reply to those, then because it is sent from a no reply address, it doesn't go through. So whosoever has sent those questions, please join the discussion group on the Moodle for this course. And then that way my answers will be visible to all the participants of this course. But because some questions were relevant and will be required for the future classes, before I begin with the topic of operational amplifiers, I would like to take just a couple of questions which were there on the Moodle site. My answer is there, but I would just like to discuss. So essentially, we are still on the topic of semiconductor devices. Actually, we will go to op amp. So one of the questions, and I think that that doubt is quite natural, asks about the difference between ions, which are positively charged, could be donors, and holes, which are also positively charged. Now, both are caused by locations which are deficient in electrons. So the question was, what is the difference between a hole and an ion? So I had covered it, but I think I went a little fast over it. So therefore, this doubt has remained, and let's just take it up so that it is clear in your mind. Consider a semiconductor in which there are four nearest neighbors always. Now we'll consider two separate scenarios. One is that we have put in a donor. That means this is a phosphorus atom, and we know that these sites are very scattered. There is only one part per million dopant and so on. So all its neighbors are actually silicon, and the lattice structure, the crystal structure, is also that of silicon. Therefore, it has four bonds to be shared with its nearest neighbors in the silicon lattice, which is the diamond type lattice. So it has four bonds to share with its nearest neighbors. So all these are silicon. However, phosphorus actually has five electrons in its outermost orbit. So it has one additional electron for charge neutrality purposes. However, nobody wants it. Nobody wants to shake hand with this. So this one, being the outside electron, is very loosely bound to this atom, and because it is not shared by two neighbors, it's kind of free to detach and go away. The amount of energy required to detach this, it's like a hydrogen atom where the inner electrons and the nucleus together form a pseudo nucleus with charge plus 1, and this one isolated electron outside very loosely bound to this. Therefore, the amount of energy required to remove this electron from the phosphorus atom is quite small, and at ordinary temperatures, practically none of these electrons are attached to their parent phosphorus atom. There is enough energy at room temperature, or even at reasonably cool temperatures, there is enough energy present to detach this electron from the phosphorus atom. So now what happens is that this guy moves away from here. It could be because of local electric fields, it could be because of diffusion. Whatever happens, this electron has now moved away, leaving this phosphorus atom pretending to be a silicon atom. It has four electrons shared with in four bonds, and those four electrons are tightly bound. However, it has a net charge left here because its nucleus is not like that of silicon. Its nucleus is that of phosphorus. So therefore, it has one additional positive charge in the nucleus, and hence this site is positively charged. This is an ion. This is an ion because it's an atom which is positively charged and which is fixed in its place. This positive ion cannot move about in the crystal. it is just fixed there. This positive charge is therefore called an ion. Now consider a corresponding scenario where instead of phosphorus we have silicon. This is where happens, this is what happens in most of the lattice. In order to create an electron hole pair, now we need fair amounts of energy. Therefore, this happens quite rarely. Indeed, out of 10 to the power 20 or 22 atoms or so, we know that number of electron hole pairs intrinsically without dopants is of the order of 10 to the power 10. So, this is a very rare event. However, it does happen. One time out of 10 to the power 10, it does happen. And when it happens, then this bond is broken, one of the bonds is broken. This makes two electrons here disconnected from each other, and one of the electrons now moves off because this bond is broken. However, this lack of electron is not localized. All the electron clouds which are forming these bonds, they are connected to each other. Therefore, there is no stamp that this electron belongs to this particular silicon atom. All of these are in an extended wave function and are jointly shared by all these neighbors. Now, if you were to apply a field, let us say that you applied a positive field, and there is a net positive charge here, which is somewhat similar to the ion, but there is a crucial difference here. There is a net positive charge here. If you apply a field with the positive end to the left here and the negative end to the right, then this entire electron cloud will have an attraction in this direction and a repulsion from this direction, all the electrons. As a result, electron cloud will shift towards this deficient silicon, leaving this guy deficient in electrons, and then eventually this guy deficient in electrons, and eventually this guy deficient in electrons, because the entire electron cloud feels this force of the field and shifts to the left towards the positive. As a result, the net deficient silicon location is not fixed in space. That is the difference. In the previous case, the electron deficient place was in phosphorus. Once this electron went away, it is tightly bound by four bonds, and nobody is willing to move electrons even if you apply a field. The electron cloud may be distorted, but there will be no net movement of charge. Whereas here, all the electrons are connected, they are all equivalent, all are silicon, and you apply a field, there is no reason why this electron, which was shared and more towards this silicon atom, will not move here and will be more towards this silicon atom, making this atom now electron deficient, and then eventually this atom more electron deficient, and so on. So, as a result, the site of electron deficiency will move when you apply a field. This is the major difference between a hole and an ionic charge. So, in the previous case, this is an ionic charge. In the current case, you have a hole. In the previous case, when the electron was plucked away from the atom, the net output apart from the crystal was that there was a free electron and a fixed site positive charge, which is ion. In the new case, you have a free electron. This bond was broken and one electron moved off, and a hole, which is mobile. And it is mobile because the entire everything is equivalent. This is a silicon atom, nearest neighbors are also silicon, there is nothing peculiar about it. And if it is electron deficient, the entire community of silicon atoms is electron deficient. And when you apply a field, the location of major electron deficiency moves in a direction as if a positive charge was moving, and that virtual particle we call a hole. and it is mobile, that is the main difference. So, I hope now the difference between an ion and a hole when ionization occurs. In both cases, an electron is wrenched away from its rightful place. Okay? So, that part is common. However, what follows is quite different, and the major difference to remember is that in one case the charge is localized, in the other case the net charge due to electron deficiency is free to move in the lattice if you apply a field. Okay? Indeed, it is also free to move if there is diffusion. So it follows as if there is a concentration of particles which are positive in charge, whereas actually it is actually deficiency of electrons. However, the major point is that they are mobile. So, I hope the difference between the two cases is now clear to you. There were a few other questions, but I think we will end up doing a devices class here, and we need to move on with op amp. So, I will answer some other questions on Moodle. They had to do with very interesting points, like for example, why should n time p remain ni squared even when the semiconductor has been changed from intrinsic to extrinsic. Okay, we have doped it. So, why should the constant that we had assumed for that chemical reaction, why should it remain the same when the properties of the material have changed? It is a very interesting question. It has a good answer. Unfortunately, we do not have the time to discuss it right now. I will perhaps take it up in a similar little insert pocket in some other course if we have time. Otherwise, I will answer it on Moodle. All right. So, finally, let us begin with CMOS op amps. So, what are op amps? This term is very widely used, and the motivation for having an op amp should be understood first, and then we will go on to see its properties and see what it actually does. So, we have all kinds of analog circuits, and each circuit is unique in its own way. You may have a filter, you may have a differentiator, you may have an integrator, you may have an analog adder, subtractor, what have you. All sorts of circuits exist, and these circuits have to be individually designed. The analog designers then look at the digital designers. Life is very simple in digital design. The circuits can be taken to be black box. As long as it performs that logic, then you do not care what is inside that black box. And the choice of operational blocks, AND gate, NAND gate, etcetera, is quite limited. So, you have standardized devices, and you just learn tricks of putting these standardized devices to accomplish the function that you want. You can make now a counter, an adder, what have you, using this logic, okay, using combinational logic or storage device. So, it makes us analog designers quite envious, because here you have anything, you have to start taking a transistor and its resistor load and its operating point and its bias, and it is a pain in the neck to design it right from the beginning. So, the question we ask ourselves is, could I please have a standard circuit like the digital guys have? Why can't I have it? So, please give me a standard circuit, which I can then use as a black box, that my circuit will be free of the details of the implementation of this circuit, as is the case with logic gates. I can perform the same function with a CMOS gate, with a TTL gate, with any gate. As long as it is an AND gate, it is an AND gate. So, could you please give me something standard, which I can use in a variety of applications without bothering about the innards of this circuit. So, because I am a sincere kind of a guy and I have made such an impassioned plea for this component, so there is suddenly Akashvani, and it says, could you be please more specific? Could you decide what this component will be, this standard component? Okay? So, as always, whenever you ask for something, you are given a homework. So, let us do that homework first. What would be this standard device with which I could perform many, many analog functions without worrying about its innards? Okay? So, let us say, and because I am a simple kind of a guy, I will choose a simple kind of a symbol for this device, which I do not know what it is right now. Now, first of all, because nothing should depend on this, on the innards of this circuit. It should not load the previous driver at all. That means it should look at its input, but not draw any current, not draw any charge or anything. That means the previous stage should not even know that there is something connected to it. Okay? Now, obviously, I am asking for the moon, but when Akashvanis don't occur every day, so I will ask for the moon. So, could I please have a device which can be connected to something and that something is not disturbed at all by it? Okay? So, what I am saying is that here is some complicated circuit, as analog circuits often are. Okay, all sorts of R, L, C transistors, God knows what mess is there. And what I am saying is that I will take this place and connect little magic component of mine. Actually, it has more inputs than one, we will come to that later. And it should not disturb the circuit at all. That means there should be no current flowing in this direction. If there is current flowing in this direction, then the circuit will know that something is connected to me. The voltage drops across these resistors, etcetera, will change, the net voltage at this point will change, and I have disturbed the original circuit. Okay? I do not want to do that. That means the input impedance of this should be infinite. Okay? So, therefore, this is one of the boons that I am asking from the Akashvani, that I want an infinite input impedance. At the output, I should be generous. That means, if the output is supposed to have some voltage, you draw any amount of current from me and my voltage will still be that predictable voltage. Okay? So, you load me with 10 ohms resistor or 10 mega ohms resistor, I do not care. My output voltage will be what it is. Right? So, I want to make that promise as well. That means, if this circuit is connected to something, maybe connected to a similar mess here, God knows what. Okay? So, it is connected to all sorts of complicated things and they might not be as well behaved as I am. They may actually draw current and they may sometimes draw less current, sometimes they might draw more current. Okay? So, then my output voltage should be predictable. It should not change. What does it mean? What does it mean for my output impedance? So, I can think of this as a Thevenin source with some output impedance, right? So, my model of the output of my op amp is some voltage source with series impedance, and what I am saying is that this is the visible output voltage, and what I am saying is you draw any amount of current from here, could be less, could be more, could be heavy, could be light, I do not care. Draw any amount of current and this voltage will not change. So, what does it say about this resistance? It should be 0. If it is non-zero, then whatever voltage I intended here, there will be a drop across this resistance and the amount of that drop will depend on how much current I am drawing. So, if I have to be totally independent of the amount of current drawn from me, okay? So, essentially what it says is I am an ideal citizen. I shall not ask for anything at my input, but I will give everything at my output and never complain, never let the world know. Okay? My lips are sealed. So, take what you want from me and my out, there will be no change in my behavior. And that is only possible if the output impedance is 0. Finally, I do not care at which frequency I am operating. Okay? So, because this has to be a catch-all device, should not, its behavior should not be dependent on which frequency I am operating on. Okay? So, my behavior should be the same at all frequencies. That means it should be frequency independent. All right. Now we have to figure out how much gain this guy should have. After all, it is an amplifier, so it has some input which is probably small, and you probably want an output which is much more. So how much gain it should have, right? So here we now have to do some more homework before we go with our next demand from the source of that Akashvani. So the question that we are asking ourselves is, what should be the gain? Okay, so let's say that I have some way of feeding back my output to the input, okay, to stabilize the behavior of this circuit. After all, we want this device to be very stable. All right, so let's say that this is some voltage that I am looking at, and notice that I shall take no current in. So let's say I have put some resistance here. I am taking just one particular configuration here. The results, however, are general. Here is my black box. I am not drawing that triangle because I will start drawing that triangle only when I have completed my list of demands. Okay? I take my output. And feed it back. Okay. Now this is my input. This is my output. And let's see what happens. Now if the input increases and the output also increases, then I have a problem on my hand. Why? All right, the input increased, the output increased, as a result the potential at this point will increase, right, because output is feeding back to this input, and if the output is now higher, the potential at this point will become higher. If this output increases, if this point, this input increases, the output will increase even further. That will raise this even further, and this will be a situation which will go run out of control. Okay, so we don't want that happening. What we would like is that the direction of change of these two should be opposite, so that on the net R1 and R2 together will be able to hold this voltage at some steady constant value. This part is clear. Okay, I want the input to remain stable. Therefore, it is clear that the gain should be negative. That means when the input increases, the output should decrease. Okay. And let us say that this gain is G. All right. So let us call this V in, call this V out, and we'll call this V X. Now notice that there is no current flowing. Input impedance is infinite, and therefore there is zero current flowing. That gives us a very simple circuit to analyze. You have V in connected to R1, and of course no current is flowing here, so we can ignore it. Connected to R2 and connected to V out, which is minus G times V in, right? It has a gain of G, so V out is negative, and the absolute value of the gain is G times V in, right? So this potential at this point is minus G V in volts, and the potential here is V in volts, and current can only flow this way. There is no flow here, all right? And that current is in fact provided by the output, which has a zero input impedance. It holds the output irrespective of what else you are doing to it. It holds the output at minus G times V X, right? It doesn't know what V in is. The op amp can look only at its input pin, so the voltage there is V X, right? So the output is minus G times V X. So this is V X. So how much current is flowing through these two resistors? Okay, you have V in minus V out divided by R 1 plus R 2. This is the total current which is flowing. Okay. So, what is V x? Remember, we cannot find out V out unless we can find out V x, right. So, what is V x? It is V in minus, okay. I am actually taking you through the longer path, but that way you will understand why op amps are what they are, all right. So, V x is V in minus R 1 times this current. You agree with me? This is the current flowing in this direction, and the drop across R1 is R1 times current. We have found out the current. Current is V1 minus V out divided by R1 plus R2. Okay? We multiply it by R1, that gives me the drop. I subtract it from V in, and that gives me Vx. Okay? So then, now, rather than writing V out as G times V x, I can write V x as V out divided by G, right. So, from here, it is V x is minus V out divided by G. Correct? We have defined the gain to be G and to be negative. Right. So, G is the absolute value of the gain. The actual gain is negative, G is its absolute value, and therefore, V out was minus G times V x, and therefore, I can write V x equal to minus V out divided by G. Okay. So, now, let us put all of this together. You had V in here coming to R 1, this is V x, this is R 2, and this is V out, which was equal to minus G times V x, and therefore, V x equal to minus V out divided by G. Okay? We had written that I is equal to V in minus V out divided by the total resistance in the arm, which is R 1 plus R 2. Remember, no current flows here. Zero current flew into the black box. This is just for reference, do not worry if you can't see it. This is Vx, and no current flows into the op amp, into the device. Okay? So now we are evaluating Vx and substituting for Vx as V out by G. Okay? So Vx is equal to minus V out by G. From here, and that is equal to V in minus R 1 times the current, which is V in minus V out upon R 1 plus R 2. Okay? So, now we can collect terms in V in and V out on two sides and can find out V out as a function of V in. Right. So, let us collect all the terms in V in on one side and V out on the other side. Right. So, this term minus V out by G, that is equal to V in minus R 1 by R 1 plus R 2 into V in plus R 1 upon R 1 plus R 2 times V out. Okay? So, this is equal to V in R 2 upon R 1 plus R 2. Okay? If I combine this two, I will get R 1 plus R 2 minus R 1 divided by R 1 plus R 2. Okay? So, this is just R 2 upon R 1 plus R 2 and plus R 1 upon R 1 plus R 2. V out, okay, and this is minus V out by G. Now, we are lazy, we will just multiply both sides by R1 plus R2, we do not like these R1 plus R2s occurring in the denominator. Okay? Just multiply both sides by R1 plus R2 and collect terms in V out and V in. So, we let us bring the term after multiplying by R1 plus R2. Okay? So, then this becomes minus R1 plus R2 by G, this term, and we will bring that. So, that will become minus R1, and this whole time whole thing is the coefficient of V out, and that is equal to V in R2. We have multiplied by R1 plus R2 to all terms. Okay? So, this is V out into R1 plus R2 by G with a minus sign. So, that is this term, and when we bring this term in, since we have multiplied by R1 plus R2, we will get minus R1 times V out. Okay? And finally, V out is then is minus V in times R2 upon R1 plus R1 plus R2 by G. Okay? So, now we have found out what is the output voltage as a function of input voltage. Right? Now, what I say is that this particular configuration should be independent of the value of G. Right? That is the theme that we have been following, that this is a generic component and the circuit should not bother about the individual properties of this component. So, we are choosing extreme properties for this component, so that nothing depends on the properties of this component. So, we made the input impedance infinite, so that it draws no current. We made the output impedance 0, so that it can supply any amount of current. And now, we want this gain, the input to output relationship, to be independent of its property. And what property is there? G. That is the only property which belongs to the op amp. Right? Everything else is external component. So, what will make it independent of G? What should I choose as the value of G? If G is infinite, this term will just drop up. And then we will have this now nice relationship that the output is related to the ratio of these two resistors times V in. Right? So, that is very nice. That means, in such configurations, whenever I have negative feedback, the output behavior will not depend on the absolute value of G, as long as G is very large. Okay? So, if G tends to infinity, now I have got a component whose individual values do not matter. Now, I can take an input and just by choosing appropriate values of R1 and R2, I can amplify it by any amount that I want. And tomorrow, if this op amp is not available, I take another op amp. And as long as its gain is large, its input impedance is infinite, its output impedance is 0, the behavior of the circuit will be exactly the same. Now, there will be no change in this device. That is very nice. Right? That is the kind of device that we were looking for. Okay? So, now I have done 2 pages of homework, and now the time is to look up towards the Akashvani and say, oh, I forgot to tell you one more thing. While you are about it, please make the gain infinite. Alright. So, now we have our demand that G should be infinite. Okay? But having done all this, I find that there is a fly in this ointment, there is something which I do not like the smell of, and that is the following. Notice that this guy, the black box, was not pulling any current. But this configuration is not leaving my V input unchanged. Indeed, there is a non-zero I that we calculated. So, that much current is anyway being supplied by my source. So, why is this current being pulled? When we had this very nice device, infinite gain, infinite input impedance, 0 output impedance, still it is loading my input. What has happened? And that is because the feedback is pulling this current. Right? No current is going here, but there is current going here. Right? So, the feedback is causing this current to flow. Right? So, I add a last minute rider saying, while you are about it, could you please give me 2 input terminals? Then, when I can afford to load the input, I will load it, but I should have the option of connecting the feedback to a different terminal and the input to a different terminal. Okay. So now here is my recipe. I have now finished my demand to the guy upstairs. So what do I want? Okay, now I can put back my simple triangle, right? My demands are not very much. I only want a circuit whose input impedance is infinite, whose output impedance is zero, whose gain is infinite, which has two inputs. That's not much, not much for the guy who is able to give Akashvanis from the sky. So while I'm asking about it, might as well ask for this. So now I have this. So I'm a modest guy, and this is what I have asked. I have asked that the gain should be infinity, that the output impedance should be zero, that the input impedance should be infinite at both inputs. Now I have two inputs, okay, and it should be frequency independent. And while I am about it, why should I have two separate kinds of same kind of inputs? What I want is that the gain should be minus g with respect to this and plus g with respect to this. In short, my V out should be g times the difference of the two inputs. This kind of an amplifier is called a difference amplifier. It does not amplify individual quantities, it amplifies the difference of two quantities. Okay? This has of its own great merit. A differential amplifier is a very convenient device to have. Why? Because very often we have noisy sources and so on. So suppose you have this mic and there is a wire, and this wire is running to an amplifier with a high gain. This wire will pick up noise. Okay. However, if I have two wires which are going to a difference amplifier and both wires pick up the same noise, then I have this with some signal riding on it and the same pickup with the opposite kind of signal riding on it. I make it differential, right? Now if I have something which amplifies the difference of this, then all this major noise simply will go away, will cancel, right? So whatever is common to the two wires will not appear in the output at all, right? So that's called common mode cancellation. Common mode cancellation says that whatever signal is common to the positive input and to the negative input will not appear in the output, because output is amplifying only the difference. If it is common, then it will cancel out in the difference. All right, this is very good because it makes it possible to make noise immune systems. Now I can bring my feedback to this guy and apply my input to this if I don't want to load my input. If I can afford to load my input and want an inverting output, then I can use this input. So I have a lot of flexibility that I can use. Okay, this element, now I have finished my demands and I hear a so be it with a thunder roll from the skies, and I get this device. It turns out, of course, this device cannot be made, but very close approximations to it are quite easy to make. Okay, so you can just amble up to Lamington Road or whatever the corresponding place is in various cities and buy an op amp for some cool 10 bucks or so. Okay, it will not set you off by much more than a couple of cups of tea. So this particular thing looked like a very immodest set of demands to make from the upar wala, but it is not too bad. Human beings can make it. You don't quite need to die and go to heaven in order to get this device. Okay, so 10 rupees will do, maybe 15, and you can get this device. Okay, so these are op-amps. Now, having got it, now we need to know what can we do with it. All right. So first, a few definitions. Remember, now I have two inputs: one which is going to the inverting input, the other going to the non-inverting input. This is V in minus, this is V in plus, and this is V out. Okay, and the same approximations apply. The real device will be somewhat different, but it will have infinite input impedance here, infinite impedance here, infinite gain, zero output impedance. Okay, and now because I have added an input, I would say that the differencing is ideal. That means if the input is zero, then the output should be truly zero. That means it should not have an offset. Okay, and its common mode rejection should be infinite. That means whatever is, it should be a true difference amplifier. Whatever is common to the two inputs must not appear in the output at all. Okay, but suppose life is not like that. Suppose I have some arbitrary voltages V1 and V2 connected. Okay, so now I define a couple of quantities. I define V1 plus V2 by 2, the average of the two inputs, as the common mode voltage. Okay, and then I define V1 minus V2 to be the difference voltage. Right. So now it is quite simple to see that V1 and V2 can be expressed in terms of VCM and VDIF. Okay. What is VCM plus VDIF? VDIF by 2. What is VCM plus VDIF by 2? Right, the V2 by 2 term will just cancel, right, and V1 by 2 plus V1 by 2. So, this is, that means V1 is nothing but VCM plus VDIF by 2, and similarly V2 is nothing but VCM minus VDIF by 2. All right, so any arbitrary voltage V1 and V2 can be expressed as a combination of these two. Their average value is the common mode value, and their difference is the difference value. Right? Now, if I have a very good op amp, then given V1 and V2, what will it amplify? G times V1 minus V2. Right? Therefore, only VDIF. There is no component of VCM in its output. Right? V1 minus V2 will just cancel out VCM. Right, it will just leave VDIF. So essentially, only the difference of the two inputs is visible to this amplifier. Right, and therefore it's called a differential amplifier. Okay, so CMOS is a differential amplifier with infinite gain, with infinite input impedance, with zero output impedance, with infinite common mode rejection ratio, and with frequency response from 0 to infinity. Okay. An ideal op amp will have all these properties. All right, let's say that we have got it. It turns out that you can get components which are very close approximations to this. So let's say that we have this device now, and let's look at a few configurations of this. By the way, notes for this lecture will be available. I have already uploaded them. They will be uploaded to your site, but I don't like to use previously prepared notes. I would like this to evolve, the whole logic of why we are doing things the way we are doing to evolve, and that's why I am using it in this mode, but succinct notes for what we have discussed will be available and will be uploaded to the Moodle site. So, the first thing we do is what we have already done. And that is this amplifier, because we did not need this input, we just ground this. Okay? You assume that the power supply to this is bipolar, and therefore, because we are taking differences, we will have negative values, right. So, we need a bipolar supply. So, assume that this power supply is bipolar, and the value of the bipolar is much larger than any input or output, okay? So that you are not limited by the value of the power supply. This is the circuit that we had analyzed. Okay. Now notice that if you have this has negative feedback, as we have seen. Let us see what happens if there is negative feedback. Why did we use negative feedback? To stabilize the output, right? Because essentially this point is being pulled up by the input, then it will be pulled down by the output. If it is pulled down by the input, then it will be pulled up by the output, right. So, we have stabilized it. That means our output is defined and finite. What was this value? This value was V out divided by G minus, correct, the value at V x. However, G tends to infinity. Right? We know that G tends to infinity. Therefore, what is the value at this point in that limit? It is 0, right? This is called a virtual ground. This point is not connected to ground, but the rate of change and the direction of change of the output is such that the output changes itself in such a way such that this point is always kept at ground, all right. Therefore, it is not connected to ground, however, its potential is guaranteed to be the same as that of the ground. Okay? Therefore, this is called the virtual ground. By assuming that this virtual ground exists, it makes the algebra of calculating the gain and so on of these op amps quite simple. Okay? So now we do not have to calculate for Vx. We painfully calculated the value of Vx from input, from output, and equated them, and then we found out what the V in V out relationship was. But we further know now that if G is infinite, in that case we can make the additional assertion that the value, the voltage at this point is 0 if this is 0. In fact, because it is a difference amplifier, the output is not G times Vx, the output is not minus G times Vx, the output is minus G times the difference of these two inputs, right. Therefore, the difference of these two inputs should be 0, and if this is grounded, this will be the virtual ground. If suppose I was to give it some other input, suppose this is V1 and I give it not ground, I give it V2, then what will be the voltage here? What should be the voltage here? It should be V2. If it is anything other than V2, then the difference of V2 and this point will be multiplied infinitely and appear at the output, right? And that cannot exist because there is negative feedback. That infinite, let us say that V2 minus this voltage is slightly positive. That means this voltage is slightly larger than this voltage. Then in which direction will the output go? Positive or negative? We are saying that this voltage is slightly positive compared to this summing point. What will the output do? In which direction will it go? The gain is plus G with respect to this and minus G with respect to this, right? So it will go to positive values. The difference is positive, and the gain is G. So, therefore, the output will go to very large positive values, right? And that large positive value will pull it up, making it equal to V2, right? This was lower than V2, but because the output has gone up and quite substantially, it will keep going up and keep pulling this point up till it becomes equal to V2, right? Similarly, should this point be a little less than V2, lower than V2, then what will happen, right? So, sorry, that is the point that we had said that V2 is a bit positive. If V2 is negative with respect to this point, then the output will go in the negative direction, right? The output goes in the same direction as this, if there is any mismatch between these. So, the output will keep going towards negative values, pulling this voltage down till it becomes equal. So, essentially the only stable point in case of this negative feedback is for this voltage to be equal to this voltage. Even a small variation from this, the output tends to bring it at the same value as the other input, okay? Because the gain is infinite, even a small deviation from it will result in a large change in the output, which will pull it down in line. Therefore, this point is kept at the same potential as this point, provided there is negative feedback. This will not be true if there was no negative feedback. Then there will be no way for the output to connect to this point, right? So, the output must be connected to this point to provide negative feedback. If there is net negative feedback, then these two must be at the same potential, and this is called a virtual short, okay? If that point was connected to ground, it would be virtual ground, but actually the more general term is that this is called a virtual short. Okay? And now, assuming virtual short or virtual ground in this case, we can quickly redo the somewhat terrible algebra that we had to do earlier and straight away see what the output should be. So, how much current is flowing down here? Now, we know this potential. It is not an unknown anymore. We know that this potential is 0, and therefore, I is nothing but V1 by R1, right? Now, there is no way for this current to flow into this device. The input impedance is infinite. Therefore, the only way this current can flow is through this resistor. And if the potential is 0 here, why should it flow that way? Only if the output is negative. And how negative should it be? So that the current flowing through R2 is I, right? Therefore, V0 should be minus R2 times I. That means it should be minus R2 by R1 into V1. So, we have a linear device. The output is a linear function of input, and the gain of this device is negative, and it is given by R2 by R1, okay? This is called an inverting configuration or inverting amplifier.